I am pleased to introduce to you my colleague, our team leader, the executive director of Louisiana Right to Life, Mr. Robert Benjamin Clapper.
Thank you, Kathy, for those warm words of welcome, and it's an honor to be here with you in Opelousas. Just a blessing on this nice morning. I'm not going to ask for a show of hands, but how many of you, and especially those who don't want to answer it maybe, were born after 1973? Just kind of keep that in mind. Now, again, I'm not asking you to raise your hands. I don't want to out everybody that was born before that. But look, have you ever thought and taken time to just be grateful for the life that you have? Oftentimes, we spend so much time thinking about others, right? Which is certainly a good thing, right? We think about the gifts and the challenges that face us in the pro-life movement in securing the rights for others. But to take a moment and to think about, especially for those of us born after 1973, that our lives were not guaranteed to us. Our own lives that motivate us every day to give glory to God and to serve others. Our days were not guaranteed in our own nation, in our own country. 44 years ago, on January 22nd, the Supreme Court, 7-2, made a decision, right? That life was not worthy of our Constitution's protection. That for some reason and somehow, it was not important enough to be guaranteed by our founding documents. And because of that, 44 years of unprotected human beings have fortunately come into this world thanks to the gift and the blessings of their mothers. How fortunate that those of us sitting here today have that gift and that blessing. So for whatever it's worth today, as long as we just say thank you to God, and maybe if your mother's still here with us on earth, pick up the phone and say thank you to her. But I want to begin my story, just a brief part of my story, in a very serious place. And thank you to Kathy for putting the cat out of the bag that I'm not from Louisiana. I appreciate that. But look, I want to start in a serious place, and it's called Chuck E. Cheese. Everyone been to Chuck E. Cheese before, right? There's one in Lafayette, right? I don't track where the Chuck E. Cheeses are across the country, but I imagine there's one here. And so just imagine me as a junior in high school, right, if you can, growing up in Mobile, Alabama. And I was at a friend's birthday party at Chuck E. Cheese. Now, this friend was my age. Don't think that was strange. It was pretty strange, in fact. It wasn't my party. It was his. His birthday party at Chuck E. Cheese. Well, lo and behold, in Mobile, Alabama, across the street from Chuck E. Cheese is the abortion facility. You know, can you imagine or can you think, can you know what the motto of Chuck E. Cheese is, right? Let me hear it. Where a kid can be a kid. Come on, say it with me. Where a kid can be a kid, right? That sounds like a great motto. Now, of course, what Chuck E. Cheese wants you to think is pizza, arcade games, large mechanical rats singing strange songs to you, right? That's what they want you to think where a kid can be a kid is, right? I sat there, the front door of Chuck E. Cheese, you know, did one of those things in your life where you look one way, look the other, look the one way, look the other, right? Chuck E. Cheese, the abortion facility. Here's Chuck E. Cheese, a place that literally makes probably 90% of its business off of birthday parties, right? That's what it does. It throws birthday parties for little children. Some of you or some of your kids, grandchildren, may have had birthday parties before at Chuck E. Cheese. And across the street was a place that literally makes its business off exactly the opposite, ensuring that birthday parties never happen. This abortion facility didn't provide other gynecological services. It didn't help women consider adoption. It didn't offer even any sort of contraceptive services. It didn't even do that. Its purpose was abortion. If a woman came in and she wasn't pregnant, she was sent out the back door. And across the street was Chuck E. Cheese. And I just had to sit there and think that in the United States of America, here in the Bible Belt, right? Mobile, Alabama, probably one of the most conservative states in the country, right off the main drag in Mobile, Alabama, is Chuck E. Cheese and the abortion facility next to each other with missions opposite. completely in conflict with one another, and yet Americans drove by every day without thinking, without even possibly conceptualizing the contradiction that existed right here. And I just am reminded that day of our Declaration of Independence, right? That one line or a couple lines that we know that goes something like this. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that some men are created equal, that they are all endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Now, is someone going to correct me? Come on, right? Some? No, all, right? It's not some. The founders of our country didn't say some. They said all men are guaranteed these rights. And the first among those rights is life. Not second, not third. It was mentioned first. Now, we know the history of our country, right? That even though this was the founding document, injustice existed right then and there in our nation. Slavery existed as they were writing these words, and I can't even imagine the conscience of the people that wrote these words and still wrote it while slavery was legal in our nation. And it existed for less than 100 years later after this document was written. And I have to imagine that this document is an ideal for our country, right? It's telling us that this is the way it should be, whether they were right or wrong on what they did at the time. But it's almost like today, now that slavery is maybe something of the past, it's like we like to think that these words are now actualized in our life, that this really is the way that it is. So, well, you know, slavery is over. All these other injustices are in the past. All men are created equal and treated equal under the law, except for those that are not yet born. And all of us here at this event know that more than many other in this nation, that not all men and women are created or protected equal. They're created equal, but not protected equal under our law. And part of our responsibility, our mission, our goal, and our time on this earth is to help restore those rights to these disenfranchised, to these devalued, to these really degraded people that should deserve every protection that you and I should receive. That's not asking for much. It's just a birthday party. All the unborn child needs is a chance. And our mission in life should be to help secure that chance. You know, abortion is a hidden injustice in our day, in our country, right? It's something abortion thrives on darkness, on making sure that light is not exposed on this issue, because people get uncomfortable when they talk about abortion. It's not an easy thing. It's not something that regularly comes up in our conversations. And there's good reason why. Just think about the numbers of abortions that face us. Since 1973 in the United States, over 59 million unborn children have been lost to abortion. I mean, can you even take a moment and try to wrap your mind around that number? Keep in mind that the population of the United Kingdom is about 62 million people. That's a lot of people. In Louisiana, since 1973, it's been 485,006 babies that were denied their birthday. 485,006 from 1973 to the end of 2015. That doesn't even include 2016. That is equivalent to the populations of the parishes of Lafayette, St. Landry, Acadia, Vermilion, and St. Mary Parish, right now, today. Every year in the United States, it's about just over 1 million unborn babies that lose their life to abortion, about the equivalent of the population of the state of Rhode Island. Every year in the United States, take 2015 for example, there were 9,311 abortions that happened in Louisiana alone. Now, compared to the United States, sounds like we're doing pretty well. But we know that every single life matters. And the potential and the opportunity denied to that life hurts all of us. Because as we know, we never know what that child may have become. But even regardless if that child becomes the best, the person who heals cancer, whatever it is, regardless if they were just a homemaker, they should have and could have brought blessing to the world. But about 9,311, that's about the size of the student section at Tiger Stadium. Every day in the United States, it's about 2,700 human beings that lose their life to abortion. 2,700. Almost the same number of people that lost their life on September 11, 2001. And then every day in the state of Louisiana, it's about 25 babies. We could just sit here and count 25 people in these pews and just imagine if they weren't here. But maybe flip it on the other side. Maybe it's the pews that are empty here that should have and could have been filled by our brothers and sisters, our neighbors, our cousins, our fellow community members. You know the joys and the blessings that you've received in growing up here in St. Landry Parish, or if you came from a surrounding parish. You know these blessings, and they're not secured for everyone. Look, it's tempting to get lost in the numbers and maybe to feel overwhelmed by what faces us in the pro-life movement, by the sheer magnitude of what abortion is and the challenge that the abortion industry faces us. And also in remembering the number of women whose lives are harmed by abortion in our society. But we cannot let these numbers, we cannot let the challenge and the size and the magnitude of what we face overcome us. We cannot think, well, I'm gonna go and march once a year and I've kind of done my part. It's so large, it's such a big problem, there's not much I can do about it. Because even though the challenges that face us are real, and sometimes it feels like every day we're losing this battle, I do believe we're winning and we are on the side of history. We're 44 years into this fight of legalized abortion in our nation. Think about the time of legalized slavery in our nation, from well before the beginning of our country to the 1860s. That's a lot longer than 44 years. But we pray, we hope, we desire, and we act in a way to believe that that arc of history will be shorter, and that in time, and I hope, before any of our lifetimes come to an end, we will see the rights of these unborn children guaranteed, protected in our nation, not just in our law, but in our culture, in our hearts, so that not only would abortion be illegal, but it would be unthinkable. And that adoption and the resources that are provided would flourish. People would know and be aware of these so that they would have every ability to make life-affirming choices that they know blesses so many people around them. You know, I often think that if we're going to be pro-life in our daily life, we got to do it with our whole selves. Because each of us is called in some way to be a pro-life advocate. And I like to think about that just kind of in the way that our body is. We have to be pro-life with our heart. We have to pray for life. We have to be compassionate for the babies and the mothers. Our heart has to be in it. Our head has to be in it. We have to know what's the best way to say something that's going to really reach the person who needs our words. We have to be pro-life with our mouth. St. Francis of Assisi said to preach the gospel at all times and if necessary, use words. Well, last time I checked, it's pretty necessary right now to use words. I think St. Francis would agree with me in this time. We can't be silent. We can't be passive. We can't be timid in this fight. We have to be compassionate. We have to be intelligent, but we can't be timid. We can't be silenced by the societal pressures to remain silent on this issue. We have to be able to say those words necessary when time comes. And I encourage you, whether it's a bumper sticker on your car, whether it's a precious feet pin on your jacket, a t-shirt, some way try in your daily life to represent the unborn child. Someone might tell you, why do you have a pair of feet on your jacket? It's a great time to start the conversation about how this is the size of the unborn baby 10 weeks after conception. You also have to be pro-life with your hands and feet, right? You're doing that today. But if we only march today, are we gonna do what we need to do to bring about an end to abortion? We're gonna do one part of it, But I believe this movement is about marching every single day in some fashion. Anybody remember the story of Joshua in the Battle of Jericho? Reach back in your Bible memory. I don't want you to think necessarily about Joshua, who kind of got the orders from God to march around the city of Jericho, right? I want you to think about that lowly person marching behind, who really probably had no clue what Joshua and the people up in the front were doing. In fact, they probably thought they were a little nuts, right? March around this city once a day for 6 days. On the seventh day, march around seven times. You think the people following Joshua thought this guy was losing it? God told you to do what? March around this massive city seven times on this one day and blow a bunch of trumpets? You know, I believe that we will see the end of abortion. I believe one day, just like our history books talk about the injustices of slavery and the Holocaust, I really do believe one day, and I pray it's with my grandchildren, that they will be studying about the Holocaust of abortion in the United States. That's really my prayer and my hope. But all I know is what Mother Teresa told me. Not me, but us. I wish she told me. That'd been great. I never met her, though. She said, we're not called to be successful. We're called to be faithful. You know what? I think that's what those marchers behind Joshua were doing. They didn't know the day, the hour, or the moment when those walls would fall. They didn't know if Joshua was crazy or he was right. But what did they do? They kept marching. And at the appointed time and at the appointed hour, those walls fell. I can't claim to know at what point the walls of the culture of death will fall in our nation and the walls of the culture of life will be triumphant. But I believe we will win. I believe we're making progress in that way. And all I know is that it's our job to keep marching and to be faithful on this call. And that means more than just today. It means every day of our life to march with faithfulness in the belief that the victory will be for justice, the victory will be for life. Amen? Amen? So as we march today, maybe what you can do is take a moment to think about how you will march tomorrow, or how you will march in 3 weeks, or who you're gonna get who's not here today to march with you in that daily march. Because I believe we're gonna win, I believe life will be victorious, and you're doing your part today, and I pray and encourage you every single day to make sure that the rights of not just some, but all will be protected. Thank you.